Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Art Inc., The Essential Guide for Building Your Career as an Artist by Lisa Congdon, narrated by Lisa Congdon. To my mother, Jerry, for showing me it's never too late to find your bliss. Foreword. Art and business in the same sentence? What are you, nuts? Maybe yes, maybe no. There is so much mythology, judgment, and suffering around the idea of art and money. When I was a kid, my mom was a gifted potter. One wall of the basement was lined with rows of industrial shelves weighted down by hundreds of mysterious powder-filled mason jars labeled things like celadon, china red, or low fire. A prehistoric-looking kick wheel anchored the space, boasting a 200-pound concrete flywheel that took out shins of unaware passers-by on a regular basis. Then came the four electric wheels and a cacophony of tools that allowed for high-speed manhandling in the name of art. On the weekends, we would pack up the Ford custom van and head off to a local outdoor street fair or market to sell the week's wares. I can't remember a time when we weren't surrounded by artisans and craftspeople, from weavers and glassblowers to painters and sculptors. So it wasn't unusual when, in my early teens, I propped an old door on some clay boxes at the far end of the studio, clamped on an old swing arm light, grabbed my grandfather's acrylics, and began to paint, and paint, and paint. As soon as I was good enough, I started hustling gigs painting album covers on jean jackets, in exchange for walking around money. Though I've traded paint for words and denim for paper, I've lived, breathed, and been surrounded by the process of creation for as long as I can remember. What's so interesting is, as a kid, the notion of any tension between art and money simply didn't exist. I loved to create. I worked to become decent at it. People paid me to do it. Simple as that. But for some reason, when you hit a certain age and a certain level of seriousness, and you start calling yourself an artist, making a living at it becomes a source of great controversy. People who have nothing to do with the exchange between you and those who would enjoy your work start to pass judgment. Money, they proclaim, bastardizes both the process and the output. Why this cultural rift emerged, I really don't know. Maybe it has to do with the establishment of a power and money structure defined largely by gatekeepers and chosen ones, external arbiters controlling the flow of not only eyeballs, but income. Maybe it comes from the ire of those who've not yet figured out how to make their calling their profession, seeking to tear down those who have, labeling them sellouts and hacks. Maybe it stems from something entirely different. Whatever the source, what's become clear to me is that you no longer have to wait to be picked. While the traditional path to love and money in art is still alive and well, the last 10 years have seen the emergence of an extraordinary array of alternative paths. Those that allow you to eschew the traditional gatekeepers and go straight to the buyers. Those that empower you to stake a claim to your own global digital gallery space and generate a legion of raving fans. Those that fuel your ability to build and generate a real living, serving everyone from collectors to consumers and even large organizations. And the best part is, you often don't have to find them. They'll find you. There's no better example than my friend, illustrator, artist, and author, Lisa Congdon. Lisa was anything but a born artist. In fact, she came to art later in life with very little formal training. Yet, in a matter of years, she built not only an astonishing body of work, but the ability to earn a very nice full-time income making art. No side gigs, no occasional shift at the local pub, no excuses. She makes art all day, every day. Lisa wakes up doing what she loves, a lot of what she loves, so much that she's become exceptional at it, and she makes a living doing it. Exactly how she made this happen and how you can too is what Art Inc. is all about. Jonathan Fields. Introduction. When I was growing up, I didn't have any plans to be an artist. I made drawings and paintings at school, but art was not something I thought I was good at. So art, as a living, had never entered my mind. Fast forward to 2001. At the age of 32, I picked up a paintbrush for the first time since sixth grade. At the time, I was working as a project manager at a nonprofit organization, and I had just ended an eight-year relationship. I was looking for a distraction, so I signed up for a painting class at a local university's extension program, brought some blank canvases home, and started painting. There, in the privacy of my apartment, I began a journey that I never could have imagined would lead me to the life I live today. In part because of that simple decision, I went from being someone with no art experience and a very basic skill set to someone who now has a full-time career drawing and painting. Prior to taking that art class, I had no idea what creative abilities were hidden inside of me. And for the record, talent didn't exactly pour out of me instantly. Curiosity, determination, and hard work played a huge role in my development. What felt different about art from former pursuits was that I was motivated by something new, an intrinsic desire to create. It was deep-seated and primal. I had to make art like I had to breathe. From this passion came a desire to expand my skills, even in areas that were out of my comfort zone. I taught myself to use new media and techniques and practiced for hours and hours until my hand felt like it would fall off. In 2005, I began sharing my work online on platforms like Flickr and Blogger. Soon, I was connecting with people who would eventually buy my work, offer me shows and galleries, and remain my friends and collaborators today. Later, as social media and online sales platforms exploded, I began using the internet in more concerted and strategic ways to build community, promote and sell my work, and build a client base. Eventually, all of my work paid off. I reached a point where I was making a steady, full-time living as an artist. I began to think about how I got to this tipping point and how other artists were making it happen too. While there is no one perfect formula that will work for every artist, I realize that there are a few clear paths and work habits that, used in some combination, can lead to consistent, paying, and satisfying work. In this book, I'll talk primarily about the paths of fine art sales, commissions, print sales, illustration, and licensing, and how you can use them in different combinations to create your own personal blueprint for success. It's important to remember that success isn't just financial. Getting checks and paying your bills is important, but it's not everything. You can define your own benchmarks for success, but no matter how savvy you are at achieving your goals or making money, unless you are creating art and selling it in ways that resonate with your values and core aesthetic, you will likely be miserable as an artist. In this book, I will share methods for finding your voice and niche so that you can feel good about your choices and stay connected to your creative process. Throughout this book, I'll also share many of my own experiences. I'll cover a range of topics central to building and sustaining a successful art business: developing your authentic voice, organizing your business, promoting your work, using social media, finding income streams that work for you, and managing the ebb and flow of your career. This book is designed to support artists at all points in their careers, whether you are a new artist who just discovered your talent, a part-time artist who wants to accelerate into making art full-time, or a seasoned artist looking for new ideas to stimulate your existing career. You may be asking, it might be possible for others, but is it possible for me? The answer is a matter of determination. While there have certainly been a few inexplicable, magical moments in my career, most of what has gotten me to where I am today are more basic things like curiosity, patience, risk-taking, and hard work. So while establishing yourself solidly in the art market might take time, the good news is that it is almost always the result of concrete action and not simple luck. With this book, you'll have the guidance and information you need to turn your artistic talents into a thriving career. With effort and dedication, you'll no doubt make your dream a reality. Chapter 1. You Are an Artist. I am always delighted when I hear stories of artists using their talents to become entrepreneurs, and it's something that happens more and more every day. No wonder. Artists are some of the world's most innovative thinkers, and many are redefining what it means to be an artist, to sell work, and to be successful. One thing I know for sure is that to be a successful artist, you must start with the simplest proclamation. I am an artist. It's a basic assertion, but seeing yourself as an artist, legitimate and genuine, can be transformational. This chapter is about just that, embracing your identity as an artist and believing you can thrive in the profession. In this chapter, you'll learn how to tackle doubts, find your voice, make time and space to work, and announce your aspirations to the world. Critical prerequisites to starting your art business. Embracing yourself as an artist. Embracing yourself as an artist is the first significant step on the path toward building your career. It's not always an easy step to take. When you affirm yourself as an artist, the road before you can feel equally exciting and terrifying. It can be thrilling when you are moving toward fulfilling your dream and spending time doing something you truly love. On the flip side, doubt can rear its ugly head, causing you to question if this profession can really pay the bills or whether you're talented enough. Many artists experience a tension between wanting to make art their livelihood and believing it is possible. But every single one of them learned through their experience that being an artist is a viable career choice. In fact, because of the potential of the internet, there are more opportunities today for working artists than have ever existed before. Artists have access to marketplaces like Etsy and shopping platforms like Shopify to sell their work. And getting your work out there and noticed has been made easier by social media platforms like Twitter, Facebook, Pinterest, Instagram, YouTube, and the like. If you feel anxious about your talent, it's important to understand that almost all artists experience insecurity at some point in their career, and often throughout their career. Maybe you don't feel worthy of success because you haven't attended art school or because you're starting your career later in life. Maybe you feel apprehensive because you aren't sure your work is good enough. But just remember that established, successful artists were once in your shoes, too. It's important to not let these fears seize your productivity or your will to work. Indeed, doubt and insecurity are feelings that can paralyze us and hinder creativity if we allow them. But when artists begin to think of their work in a more positive light, doors open and success follows. Simply telling yourself, "I can do this," or "this is possible," works wonders. And remember that the first few years of an artist's career, being the new kid on the block, is actually a really magical and memorable time. So enjoy it. The thriving artist mindset. Much of what separates successful artists from those who struggle is simply their mindset. Struggling artists often create obstacles in their minds by making erroneous assumptions about the way the world works. They give weight to the starving artist myth, part conventional belief that pursuing a career as an artist leads to financial struggle, and part romanticized notion that art is better when created in a state of deprivation. But the starving artist myth is just that, a myth. And believing in any part of it will keep you from becoming a thriving, working artist. Creating a flourishing art practice comes from passion, talent, and hard work. Promoting your work means that people will know what you do, and selling your work will support your livelihood and allow you to make even more art. This is the thriving artist mindset. Artists who possess this mentality are not frightened by the notion of making money. They think in terms of possibility and abundance, not limits and scarcity. They've given themselves permission to thrive. Shifting your mindset. Which mindset do you possess, that of a starving artist or a thriving artist? The following are statements that a starving artist would say versus a thriving artist. Determine which category your thoughts most often fall into. Starving artist mindset. Focusing on how to make money from my art prevents me from making good work. Good art markets and sells itself. I shouldn't have to actively promote my work. The only way to be successful as an artist is to get into a really good gallery. Having little money and suffering from my art will make me a better artist. Thriving artist mindset. Putting effort toward making a living from my art allows me to do what I love. I proudly and actively share my art and talent with the world. Doing this helps my work sell so I can make a living. There is no single perfect way to be a successful artist. I will allow myself to explore and discover new creative avenues I might also enjoy. Making good work comes from passion, talent, and hard work. If most of your thoughts were aligned with the starving artist mindset, there's no need to be worried. There are practical things you can do to move from fear to action. First, pay attention to the negative messages you tell yourself about what is possible and write them down. Next, shift the messages by changing pessimistic statements to more positive ones. Surround yourself with people, including other artists, who support your aspirations and dreams. Supportive friends, family, and mentors can serve as inspiration for what is possible. Last, work to find your voice as an artist. Finding your voice will help you build confidence that will carry you through times of doubt. Understanding and appreciating your own unique perspective as an artist will contribute enormously to your motivation, work ethic, and sense of potential. Finding your voice. As an artist, you have the opportunity to create your own unique stamp on the world. This is the artist's voice, and it's a mixture of message, style, and technique. Everyone has a different process for finding his voice. It's not something you can simply learn through books or study. It requires you to pull from deep inside yourself to find what moves you and to express that through what you create. Developing your voice can be a lifetime journey, a continual process of discovery and reinvention. As you get older, your values and drives may change, and you may learn new techniques. And all of this affects your voice and the work you create. Everyone's progress will be different, and there's always a bit of trial and error involved. If you create work that doesn't feel authentic, that's also an important realization and helps eliminate what you shouldn't be doing. Create art for yourself. Often, when you start creating art, there's a common misunderstanding that there is one correct way to paint a picture or throw a pot, that the process you learned is the method everyone is supposed to use. Your initial technique will likely be a great foundation, but make sure it doesn't become so fixed that it locks you into just one style or even subject matter. It's an incredibly liberating moment to start making work that reflects your identity and core aesthetic, not that of your teachers or your classmates. Take risks. When making art, it can feel scary to change your work even slightly, especially if you are used to doing things in a particular way. But doing something differently, however small, automatically pushes your work to a new place. You can take small risks by using different colors than you normally use, or adding or subtracting a medium. It might mean trying a new subject matter or narrative. In the process, you may discover that you need to take even larger risks. The results of these risks are what will set your work apart. Push through difficulty. My painting teacher used to talk about the painting curve, a line that looks like the letter U. He said that when you begin a painting or other form of art, you are at the top of the U. Things look clean and wonderful in the beginning, but as you develop a piece of work, it often gets messier. That is the bottom of the painting curve. He insisted that working through the bottom of the painting curve, the point at which we think our work looks horrible or awkward, is critical to making good work. Working through the complexities of a piece to the point where it looks and feels wonderful again, rising back up to the top of the U, helps develop your technique as well as your unique voice. Find what inspires you. Inspiration does not always come to us in a flash. We often have to go in search of it, especially when we feel stuck. Finding inspiration means discovering the things that make you excited, even when they have nothing to do with your art practice. If you go on a trip, you might find inspiration in architecture, landscapes, or traditional patterns found in old cultures. Whatever speaks to you, infuse these visual stimuli from your life into your work. To work through anxieties or find out what ignites your interests, it helps to carry a journal to do daily entries. Maintaining a journal with both written and visual thoughts is a long-standing tradition among artists that helps you ignite creativity and work through blocks. There is no right or wrong way to keep a journal. You can use a book with lined or unlined pages. It can be a written diary with stream of consciousness thoughts, or a purely visual notebook with pages of drawings. One thing that is helpful, though, is to choose a journal size that is portable so that you can carry it around with you. Make a habit of writing or drawing in your journal every day. Some days you'll only have a quick 5 minutes, and other days a whole hour to devote to it. Don't worry about whether your writing makes any sense or your ideas or drawings are any good. Eventually, a pattern will emerge that will help unlock your mission as an artist and even identify new avenues for exploration. Take a break from the internet. To home in on your voice, you must first abandon the messages in your mind that tell you how you should be doing something so that you can free yourself to create art that is authentic to you. Sometimes we get caught up in the trap of comparing ourselves to other artists. The internet is a great place for artists to sell and promote their work, but it can also be a distraction. At any time, you can open your computer and have immediate access to the work of thousands upon thousands of artists. Looking at the work of other artists can be motivating, but it can also be intimidating. You might question whether your work is original enough, or conversely, whether you fit into any particular trend. Turning off the computer, finding your own inspiration, and exploring your own creative process may get you much further than studying the work of other visual artists. Detach from other artists' work. Many artists go through a period where they feel a need to make their work look like what they consider good art, like creating work in a vein similar to their favorite contemporary artist or the work of an old master. Consciously or unconsciously, artists may initially hold ideas about what is acceptable and good and what is not. To carve out your artistic voice, you'll need to detach yourself from images of what you think constitutes successful work. This might mean a period where you avoid looking at the work of other artists on the internet or books with images of your favorite work. Pay attention to your inner compass, advises artist Josh Keyes. It's easy to get caught up in the speed and blur of social media and exterior influences and expectations. Get to know your center and what propels and ignites your creativity. Finding time to make art. If you're holding down a full-time job or raising a family, the thought of making time for art can feel like a luxury or an overwhelming addition to your schedule. You'll have to genuinely embrace the fact that your life might feel full for a while and that carving time for art will require some discipline. Here are some simple ways you can find time to make art. Schedule time. Block out chunks of time in your calendar to make art, even if it's only 2 hours a week at first. Doing a little bit each week might not seem like a lot, but over time, it adds up. Incorporate art into your social activities. Make art during quality time with your children, partner, or friends. Create collages with your kids on a Saturday afternoon, or gather a group of friends to draw with you. Reduce screen time. Use the time you normally spend surfing the internet or watching television for making art instead. Delegate chores. Having another family member take over a few chores can open up some free time for your art. If you're unable to pass any household duties to other people, don't feel bad about letting go of things. Bring a blank journal with you everywhere. When pockets of time open up, you can pull it out to sketch, draw, or brainstorm ideas. Take an art class. While it takes time, enrolling in classes will force you into art-making mode and into a schedule. Going to a class can also lead to new creations, not to mention finessing your techniques or even adding a new one to your repertoire. A space of one's own. Setting up a space for your creative work is as vital as making time for your work. The important thing is to find space to dedicate to your creative process, even if it's a tiny corner of a room. First, make your space inviting. It helps to pin up pieces of inspiration, have a comfortable place to sit or stand, and keep the area clean and organized after every use. Also, you should have everything you need at your fingertips. Setting up an area that houses all of your supplies will free you up to create and eliminate potential excuses for why you cannot begin. Finally, make it your own, but be willing to make compromises. Sacrifices may be necessary, like moving your television to make room for an easel, and the space may also determine the scale of your art. For example, if you are a painter or sculptor, it may force you to work a bit smaller than you might like. If you need privacy when you work, make sure it's in a space in your home where you can place a room divider or close the door. Surround yourself with support. When you are pursuing your dreams, you may also encounter friends and family who tell you your goals are not possible. Surrounding yourself with people who support your aspirations and believe in your dreams will not only strengthen your confidence, but create connections that can further your career. Reach out to artists in your community who are also just kicking off their careers. If you admire someone's work or success, don't be afraid to ask them to coffee or invite them to see your work. Eventually, you will begin to build a community of friends. It's amazingly encouraging to get support from like-minded people, and you'll find you're also able to lend support to them. Many years later, those relationships will be some of the most important in your career. Chapter 2, Getting Down to Business. Understanding how to run a small business is essential to making a living as an artist. The good news is that everyone possesses the ability to be a successful entrepreneur. With some basic tools, knowledge, and practice, you can run your art business with dexterity. You may find that running an organized business brings you a tremendous amount of satisfaction and pride. In this chapter, we will cover the business basics: developing values and goals for your business, branding your business, exploring income streams, and setting up financial record keeping.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.